This is the 11th video of our computer-aided archaeology course and the second video on C14 calibration, and in this session we will go beyond the simple calibration of individual C14 dates and use the full potential that OxCal, but more in general, Bayesian statistics can offer us, because most of the time individual dates are somehow related to each other and we can use this relationship and knowledge about this relationship to come up with more precise information about the temporal position of individual events. So this will be the general topic of this session. How can we improve the information gain using OxCal, or more precisely using statistical methods, and precisely Bayesian methods most of the time. We will start off with rather direct topics, how we can improve the precision of dating by combining multiple dates from which we know that they come from the same event. And also I will like to introduce to you the wiggle matching, which is an approach that you most dominantly can use when you have C14 dates from tree rings, and when you know how far the individual events, so the individual tree rings, are differentiated in time, how far they are in years from each other. And then we can use the possibilities to derive some information from the individual dates in total about sites and their use, the use time of sites. So the most simple approach is to use summed calibration, summed probabilities, and summed calibration with that. But this is straightforward, but it has some drawbacks. And for that, there is a Bayesian approach to that, with which you, for example, can calculate or estimate the duration of the use of different sites using a simple model. When it comes to more advanced models, we will talk about stratigraphical modeling. And here the topic is sequential calibration. So we introduced that already in the last present section when I introduced to you how Bayesian calibration works and how you can introduce stratigraphy into a calibration. But here we will go more specific how you can do that in OxCal. And as always, the real technical way of how you do that in OxCal I will describe in the individual technical videos that will be available also on the website. So let's jump in and start with the combine function. Combine is a function that's very simple. It is used to calculate a probability distribution for a specific event using multiple measurements of the same event. The goal is to get a better estimation of the event by combining these dates, and it is essentially the same as if you would measure an individual measurement longer. So you take multiple measurements of the same object and you kind of make a mean of these measurements, and with that it has the same effect as if you would reduce, for example, the standard deviation by measuring a specific element longer, or a specific sample longer. We can't control that. Usually we get the dates from the laboratory, so this might be very helpful in cases when you want to have a more precise date, if you have actually samples coming from the same object. So with combining the same dates to a common combined date, we impose some strong assumptions on our calibration. That means we actually assume or propose to the calibration software that all the dates refer to really the same event. And that means it can only actually be used for samples that have taken for the same object. So measurements, several measurements of several bones from the same individual, where we are sure that all the bones died at the same time. So we are not measuring differences, different events. We are really measuring the death of one individual. And with bones, there is a bit, it's a bit tricky, but we will come to that slightly a bit later. Or if we measure several grains from the same deposit, where we think that these grains represent one harvest, and so they should be harvested and deposited in the same year. So in that case, we also can think of that we are measuring the same event. Sometimes sometimes also done, but it's questionable, is that, for example, if you have multiple samples from the same grave, for example, bones or other sort of material, some people also combine these measurements, but the problem is bones accumulate C14 over a longer period, and so they not precisely reflect the time of death of the individual. Usually it's not a big problem, but because we are measuring bones and we're measuring the same process in that situation. But if you combine that with short-lived material, maybe there might be a problem, or the short-lived material could have introduced into the grave at a different point in time. So whenever you're not sure that you are dating really the same event, you should not combine stuff. On the other hand, it's a very easy way to improve the precision of C14 dating by combining multiple measurements, so it has its benefits in that situation, if you can make sure that you're really combining dates from the same event. Okay, how this is done, and I will give you for this and other some other examples, I will give you some small experiments how you can do that. I use a bit R code here, and I did the calculations in R, but it is just to show you what the structure behind that is, and you do not necessarily have to do that in R or any other specific statistical software. The thing to do it, the method to do it, is to use OxCal for that. So let's assume we have two measurements of this of the same bone of an individual, or probably multiple bones of, but especially of the same individual that died 1950 C14 years ago. Not calendar years, but really C14 years. So we assume that they should have been exposed to a specific C14 content in the atmosphere, and we should have the same age in C14 years with that. And to spread the measurements a bit, I made here two random normal distributed choices around these specific years. This could reflect the uncertainty of different measurements. And these are fairly widespread, although we have a standard deviation of 25 years for our normal distribution. But here we have a 50-year difference of the different measurements. So assume that these are C14 dates. One says 1926 and one says 1976. BP uncalibrated, and for both we assume a standard deviation of 25 years. Although we have the same individual, these dates, because of the measurement uncertainty, can have different values. Okay, how can we handle that now? If we measure them and if we draw the probability distribution of the individual measurements without calibration, this would look like that. So we have the measurement here, the BP, and the standard deviation that results in this Gaussian distribution of one date and here the second date. There's a larger part overlap. Since we know that both of these dates must reflect the same event, there is the possibility to ignore parts of the probability distribution from this date, because it should also date, or the same event should also be dated by that date, and to ignore from the other date parts of this probability distribution. What is more likely is that both dates, when they date the same event, they should come up with the same range here. So the truth is probably somewhere around where both dates are overlapping each other. And you can see this is exactly the part where we have 1950. That's where we started. So we would expect, since we know the ground truth here, that the actual date is more centered around this part, and these probability distribution parts here are to be ignored in a way. So how can we do that with a computational approach, with a mathematical approach, without knowing the ground truth? So since we are sure that this date's the same event, we can treat this as a common probability distribution. If we just individually calibrate these dates, we will see that this is the calibrated result. So there's also a shift between these two dates here, approximately around 0 to 100 AD would the calibration here be. E not a null, that's just an effect from R. So now when we want to combine these individual probability distributions, the truth is in the center, or we could also say we have to multiply the probabilities, because the probability that this date is actually here, the event actually took place here, and what we actually wanted to measure is this amount of C14 here, is the probability of this measurement times the probability of this measurement, because they reflect the same event, and so in that case we can multiply this. The statistical or the mathematical reason for that, I would explain to you in the statistics course, or those that have visited that know that independent evidence can be multiplied, and so this is the reason why this is possible here. So it's a really simple multiplication of the uncalibrated results with which we will come up with this combined probability distribution for both individual measurements. And you can see that this peak here is smaller. It reflects the exclusion of one probability part here due to the fact that the other date is not overlapping here and the other way around. So we have a smaller standard deviation in a way. And this causes also the peak to be higher, because the total probability of 100% sure that something took place has to be distributed over a smaller area here. And with that we get a more peaked probability distribution, a more precise date, and with that also the calibration will come up with a more precise date. So this is what the result would be here. This is our first or second sample, this is our first sample, and that here is the combined sample, and you can see that it has a not so wide distribution as the others. So this date, for example, roughly dates from 0 to 200. This date roughly dates from minus 50 to plus 50 roundabout, while this date is only 100 years spread here. It's not a precise, I do not give you the precise 95% confidence intervals here, but you can see from the picture and also by glimpsing at the plots that you will get a more condensed date by combining these individual dates. So if you have a single process, then it can more accurately be dated by several dates by combining them. And again, dating of a single grave can be estimated more precisely if we have more than one date from this buried person, and again it must reflect to the same event. So same event, multiple dates for that. And this works without Bayes. The assumption is that all dates of the dating should be equal or have the same background, and with that we can simply, without any Bayesian statistics, combine them. But you never should combine dates when you're not sure that we are actually dating the same event here. This is how you would phrase that in OxCal, and I will give you a short video on the technical part how you can do that, but it's really straightforward here. Okay, that was the combined part. Now, what if you have multiple dates but they are not dating the same event, but you have an estimation about the temporal distance between these events? You have again more information than just the individual date, and also this you can use to come up with a more precise result. For example, if you have tree rings, then you definitely know how many years are between the individual samples, so you can take multiple samples from different tree rings of the same tree, and then you can count the years in between the individual samples, and with that we have a lot of information additionally. With that we know how far the individual dates are spaced. You can also use that in depositional processes when you do not know the precise distance, but you have an estimation about the relative distance of the individual dates from each other. And this is also what the animation that we'll see in a second is about. But if you have even more precise absolute information about the distance of the dates in years, you can come up with a much more precise result. Again, we are making strong assumptions about the temporal arrangement of our sample. That means we introduce a model here, and if your model is wrong, your result will also be wrong. So there's a lot of more responsibility on you to really come up with a correct model, to come up with precise and correct dates, than if you just would simply calibrate the individual date here. And you can see here in the plot, here's the result of one of these wiggle matching. You can see the different samples here on the calibration curve, and you can already estimate that this works like a key lock principle. You will find the position where these individual dates are placed best on the calibration curve if we have an exact distance here and if we know this distance here. So if we have an individual date, we have a straightforward calibration, and we will find the most likely temporal position, and we can also plot that on the calibration curve here. It just comes from the measurement and the shape of the calibration curve, and here you can see if we calibrate this date here, there's quite a long possibility, quite a wide possibility distribution of this individual date, because we are here in a plateau. Usually this is a bad situation, because with this plateau we don't have so precise information from the calibration. But in the case of a wiggle matching, we can use the shape of the plateau and also the surrounding shape of the curve to come up with a better solution. So let's assume we have much more dates and we know the temporal distance between them, and now we need to find the best possible fit of these individual dates with known distance to each other on the calibration curve. In that case here, it's a depositional model, it's not a tree ring model, so there is also the possibility to stretch all these different distances or expand them. In a tree ring situation, this would also be constrained. You cannot stretch this. We know precisely how far the distance would be. So in this case, we can use this information to come up with the best fit. Here we also stretch and compress the individual distances that have a relative distance to each other. In the case of the tree ring situation, when we have absolute distances, there's only one possible solution to where all the dates fit best. There is a specific solution where all the dates fit best on the curve, and there is a bit of arrangement around that. And with that, we can come up with a more precise date. How does it work technically? It's essentially like I have shown you how you can calibrate two dates in a stratigraphical situation. Only that this time we're not assuming that one date must be older, but we have precise information how much older the other date must be, and with that we can come up with a more precise setting than if we have just the stratigraphical information of two dates. So with this you can come up with very, very precise dating up to 5 years, for example, when the C14 calibration itself would probably give you 100 years or 200 years of possible distribution of the individual dates. Here again, so if we know this temporal distance of the events and of the individual dates, then we have more information available to come up with a better calibration. We are making strong assumptions, so you better be sure that your date, your tree ring count is correct. This is how you would do that in R, in OxCal. There is something as a sequence here, which assumes that all these dates are in a specific sequence. Then we have the individual C14 dates, and you can see here is a gap indicated, so we know that each date has a gap of 10 years in between them, which are probably the count of the individual tree rings. And we know that this date must be 10 years younger, older than this date, for example. Again, I will show you that in a technical video, how this works. Third thing, if we now want to have more general information of a site using multiple C14 dates, you probably could want to know how long the duration of use of a site would be. And the most straightforward way of doing that is to do a sum calibration. So we just put all the dates together and come up with the joint probability distribution of the individual dates. So in that example here, we have 40 dates, and this total curve here reflects the combined probability of all the individual dates here. So with that, we could get a rough overview how long a burial ground was used or how long the occupancy of a settlement was. But it's a very, very simple statistics. We just sum up everything and ignoring that there is a statistical scatter from the individual dates. And so we will come up with an overestimation of the site duration all the time if we do a sum calibration. And the Oxcol manual is very clear about that. There is little statistical justification to do that, but it can give you a first glimpse of the duration of a site or the duration of a phenomenon. To have that more precisely, we can use Bayesian models for that. I will come to that in a second. But still, it's very helpful to have an idea how this sum calibration works. For that, let's go back to our original two samples here. Remember, we have sample 1 and sample 2, and these were the measurements. And we know the ground truth here, that they actually come from the same event. But in that situation, we don't care for that case. And also, to do a sum, you definitely not need to have examples or samples from the same event. We already from the beginning assume that we have multiple events, and we want to have these multiple events are connected somehow, and we want to have the total duration of these multiple events, so the total duration of a specific phenomenon, like for example a burial ground. We still use these examples here. So here is again how the individual measurements would look like in respect of their probability distribution, uncalibrated. And again, the calibration of the individual dates here. You can see that we have these two peaks here. And if we want to combine, have a rough estimate over the whole distribution of the site, we would probably combine, just overlay these two probability distributions and come up with a combined probability distribution. We can do that, or we should, or it's done before the calibration, and then the total combined probability distribution is calibrated at once. So it's essentially the same kind of structure like we had before with the combine, because also this is again a procedure that takes place before the calibration. If we have two independent events, their probability can be added to come up with a total probability here. In that case, we get an not a probability in a strict sense, but we get expectation value, so-called. And if we then normalize that to the total amount of probabilities, we get again a probability distribution which has a maximum value of 1 that reflects the total probability of the whole phenomenon on the site measured by multiple events. So if we do this plus, if we add up the probability distribution of all the individual years here, so and normalize that, if we add that up, of course this would be bigger, the heap that we would get. If we normalize that again to the total probability of 1, we get a mountain here, a Gaussian curve, which is not strictly a Gaussian, which has a wider top because we now have the combination of these two probabilities. So we go for each individual point in time, we take the sum of these, and then we normalize that so that the total shape, the total curve, has an area of 1 again. So that's the sum calibration. This also takes place before the actual calibration, and then we calibrate the whole new probability distribution of the combined result here using the calibration curve. This then looks as a result like that. So you can see we have the combination of the information of both events here. We have this peak here from the sample 2, also reflected in the sum, and we have these peaks here from sample 1 also reflected in the sum, and in total we have a wider distribution, and it's a rough estimate of how long the site duration or the duration of the phenomenon might have been. But again, we get also all the statistical scatter from the individual measurements, so there is always an overestimating of the sum. So if you want to have a rough overview, it's a very simple tool. It also runs fast in Oxcal, and you don't have to think too much about your model. But on the downside, It is also not a very sophisticated model, so you will get very imprecise result from that. And this is again the Oxcal code. It's also very simple and straightforward. I will explain that in a technical video. If we want to go beyond that and want to have a more precise estimate about the duration of a site and the probable beginning and end of the site, we have to do some basic modeling here. Again, we have the same use cases, the total use of a burial ground, for example, or the total occupancy of a settlement. And now we have to introduce a bit more structure here, which you also can see in the result table here. We will introduce boundaries, and we will introduce things that are called phase and sequence. What you also will see here, before we only have seen unmodeled calibration results, and now you will see something that's called modeled here, and you see that the numbers are different in this situation. With the model, we introduce more information, because we, for example, introduced that we know that a site started somewhere and ended somewhere, and all the things here in between are somehow connected to the same process. And with that, there's also the possibility to remove some probabilities from the individual burials, from the individual dates, because we know that these are somehow, or we assume that these are all somehow connected events. And with that, we can add additional information, and with additional information, the model or the calibration results can be more precise. So what do we need to add? We need to add this sequence here. And the sequence in the Oxcal language says whatever follows has a specific order from older to younger in the standard view. Older, the oldest thing would here the start of our site, and this is the boundary. We say we don't know when the start of the site took place, but it has a specific boundary. It is a specific event that started the use of the site. And we want to have an estimation of when this event took place. And the same is here at the end. This is the end boundary. And I've just named them S and E for start and end, but you can also name them as you wish. So the boundary, the start boundary, is the first event here in our sequence, and the end boundary, the end of the use of the site, is the last event of the use of our site. And in between, we have a phase, this use phase here of the site. And in a phase, the order doesn't play any role. So we have several dates here from this phase, but we don't know in which order the individual events within this phase took place. So we put them into this phase. So whenever something is sequential, we know an order, we have a sequence. Whenever something cannot be sequenced, we put this into phase, and these are for our individual burials, for example, on this side. And what represents a border between events is a boundary. So we put a boundary here and a boundary here, and in between we have our phase. And then we have also a query here, that's span. And span is a query that asks the most likely duration of the use of the site, given that we have the C14 dates and the total model, so our sequence of events and a start boundary and an end boundary. With that, we get this new modeled informations here that are represented in this column here. So the unmodeled are just the C14 dates, and you can see that for these we have only values here. These are the direct calibration without any modeling. But for the modeled dates, we have an estimation of the start boundary, saying that the site has started somewhere between 1469 and 1223 BCE. And we have the end boundary, which gives also us an estimation about the start, the possible start and the possible end. There is some range here. And then we have the informations of our dates, and these information are also condensed a bit because we have added these boundaries here, and so we're saying these things belong together to a phase of a duration we do not precisely know. But with that, this limits also the possibility how far these different events, for example, might be different or distinct from each other in temporal perspective, and that's why also here we can narrow down the probability a bit. Then we have also, I added here for this run the question which is probably the first use and the last use, and also for that, this is also queries, we can get an estimation, and also an estimation about the span of use, and the most likely scenario here is with 95% confidence that the site was used between 0 years, so everything took place at the same time, and 143 years, which is the most likely maximum duration of this site use. We can also see that as an individual plot in OxCal, and here you can see it's more likely that the duration of the site was shorter than 50 years, but there's also probability that it was used a bit longer. And with 95% probability confidence, we can only say that it dates, or it was in use between 0 and 143 years here. Okay, so this was a very simple model where we just introduced the boundaries, and with that we get the more precise estimation of the use of a site, more precise and with more statistical value or information than if we would just sum up the sites. So if you want to really to have an estimation about the duration of a site use, you should go for this kind of simple model with some boundaries and a phase where you put all your C14 dates of that phase into it, and then you get an estimation about the duration that's more reliable than if you just would do a sum calibration, because we get rid of this statistical scatter at the edges of the site that comes from the random chance of the C14 dates. But we can use the same structure if we have more information and put more of these phases to each other, because in a sequence we can have multiple phases, and with these multiple phases, if we know that there are differences of these phases, and these phases represent time horizons where we don't know the order of the dates, but we know the order of the different phases, then we can come up with something that is called sequential calibration, with which we can have stratigraphic information influencing our calibration. For example, if we have layers on excavation where we know the order of the dates, some people also use that to include typological considerations. If we have the sequence from different artifact type, you can introduce that, but with this kind of modeling, so you produce a model and the result will depend on how good your model is, and if there is something wrong with your typological considerations, also the resulting calibration will be wrong. This can be used as a heuristic tool, but you should not rely on this situation. On the contrary, if you have stratigraphic information and you can rely on the stratigraphic information, then you can come up with a much more precise C14 calibration using this stratigraphic information. Again, we also make here strong assumptions about the temporal arrangements of our sample, and this will influence the calibration result. So when the stratigraphy is wrong, also the resulting calibration here will be wrong. That's not a magical tool that knows the answer, but it just reflects the amount of information that you give to the tool with the C14 in it and the stratigraphy, and comes up with the most reasonable scenario for this model here. Okay, so how do we do that? Again, sequence is everything that takes place in an order, and what cannot be sequenced is a phase, and we can connect that with this kind of Harris matrix approach, where we say, for example, this must be our youngest date, then we have another date here that is somehow related to that. So we have a first phase, then we have here a second phase where we know everything needs to be younger than this date 2 here, for example. So whatever comes from this and from this must be younger, so we have one phase, and then we don't have any information about these individual dates here. We have probably multiple dates, so we can put each of them again in a phase, and the whole thing here in a phase, and with that we can transfer the information from a Harris matrix into a sequence and phase model in OxCal with this very, very simple syntax. So we have ordered things and we have unordered things, and we nest them into each other, and with that we can reflect the Harris matrix, and with that the stratigraphical information about our dates. And you can go arbitrarily complicated with that. So for example, this is a real world model, or this is a real world model where you can see we have phases of use, and then we have boundaries between them, and then we have sequences within these phases where we know that we have two sequences here from which we don't know what their temporal position in respect to each other is, but we know that this that inside of them we have again stratigraphy, so we can arrange C14 dates here. Here we have another phase inside of the sequence where we have two dates where we don't know the temporal or the stratigraphic position of these two dates, but we know that these are older than these two dates, so we can put them in the sequence here, and so on and so forth. So with that, you can reflect very, very complicated Harris matrices and come up with a very precise result. And the more structure you can bring into the model, the more precise your individual dating will be. Up to 10 years of precision, for example, so we can get up very, very precise compared to the general C14 calibration where you have probably 100 years of standard deviation or of uncertainty in the individual dates. I should not talk about standard deviation, that's something that only is applicable to, for example, normal distribution or something, some distributions that behave in a nice way, while we have this wiggly, unnice calibrated results here. Okay, so this is a very simple model here where we have our Harris matrix that I invented for the spurious site of Miskovice, where we have here individual C14 dates, and we have here a phase, then we have here a second phase with subphases of individual dates here, and here probably we could have stratigraphic information, then we would have a sequence inside of the phase, but if we don't have them, this is just a phase. So we have essentially three phases here, phase 1, phase 2, with phase 2a and phase 2b, and phase 3. And we can use this structure and the 14 dates to come up with this kind of sequential model, where we have our sequence and then phase 1 and then the C14 dates from these two graves here below. Then we have a boundary between these phases. If we have stratigraphic reasons to assume that there is a sequence, then we probably would also have a boundary here between these two phases, and then we can also estimate when the phase transition was from phase 1 to phase 2 using this boundary command. And so on and so forth. And here we have our youngest phase. This is this grave 27 with this C14 date, and this goes in here. And now, if we calculate that, we get this kind of modeled information with our different phases and the whole sequence here. And this model is not very, very constrained, because there is only these three phases in a sequence, but in the phases and also in the subphases we don't have any order here, so there is not so much reduction of the C14 dates going on here, but still we lose 100 years of uncertainty, for example, so it still is helpful to narrow down the individual datings of these phases. The more stratigraphic information you can bring into that, the more precise will the resulting sequential calibration be for you. And again, also here, if your model is wrong, your results will also be wrong. So it really depends on that you have good reasons to assume that these phases are stratigraphically differentiated, so that you can use this information to come up with a more precise dating. So the reliably the responsibility is on you for the reliability of your model and of your calculation. But if you accept this responsibility, you can come up with much more precise results than by just simply calibrating the individual dates. So we use these boundaries in OxCal, and we just use the simple boundary function here, which assumes that something stopped there at the beginning or the end of the boundary, and there is constant probability within these boundaries. But there are other boundary functions with which you can model more complicated scenarios. For example, you have some external information that there were more graves in the center, in the middle of the use of this burial ground. Then you can use these sigma boundaries to model this this scenario, where you introduce into the model that we have more individuals here in during the center of the use than in the beginning or the end. Or here is a situation where we probably have a high occupancy of the of a site, and then this occupancy lowers over time. If you have external information, you can introduce that, or you can actually test different scenarios and say, okay, let's see if we compare this scenario with this scenario, which model gives us a higher probability of being true. And with that, you can use that also as a heuristic tool to test different assumptions about your site and the distribution of the evidence on the site. Now, that's a very advanced topic already, and you can do a lot of things wrong with this kind of boundary modeling. The most secure situation is if you really rely on stratigraphic information and use the standard boundary. If you deal with some topological reasoning, there's a specific boundary for that. That's this trapezoidal boundary here, which assumes that there is a bit of overshoot possible from the time when you assume that your type comes into play, because there's probably types that we do not have in the archaeological record, and maybe at some sites this type was not used at that time. So with that, you can also model this scenario. But this is, as I said, a quite advanced topic, and it is used, but I would strongly recommend, before you actually start modeling stuff like that, you should consult the literature on that by Bronk Ramsey and others, and get an idea what actually is behind that and how it works and how it will influence your calibration. But the sky's the limit. You can see there are a lot of possibilities here to work with different kinds of evidence and different kinds of models to come up with some interesting interpretation models and possibilities to get either more precise dates or test different scenarios using your C14 dates and the different possibilities of Oxcar. And there are even more possibilities. For example, if you assume that certain dates might be outliers already because they have a bad source material, bad sample material, you can start using outlier models. Or if you have information about the depositional processes, you can use these depositional models here. We used the D-sequence already for the wiggle matching, but there are other options here. To get a full overview what is possible, I would strongly recommend you to use the Oxcar help page and get an overview of what is possible. Probably you will use only a very limited amount of the possibilities of Oxcar, but it's, if you don't know that these options are there, you probably will not have an idea that you could use them if you would actually need to have them. So I strongly encourage you to just go over it and have get a basic idea what you can do with Oxcar beyond the simple sequential calibration, and especially beyond the simple tools like sum calibration or combine. Okay, that was it for this theoretical video. I will again give you the practical video how you can do these individual ways of analyzing your C14 dates in the technical videos, and I'm looking forward to see you all in the next presence session.